Solar panels are now required on all new homes in California. So that's about 80,000 new homes each year that are getting solar. In October of 2020, California ranked as the highest solar power generating state in the nation, producing enough solar capacity to power about 8.4 million homes in the state. And in 2020, the SEIA estimated that California will increase its solar capacity by over 19,000 megawatts over the next 5 years, second behind Texas at 20,000 megawatts. And I happened to get my solar panels on my house just over 4 years ago in March of 2017. And in that time, I've learned a lot. My solar panel setup at my house contains 16 panels and generates just over 5 kilowatts of peak power. These 16 panels feed into a string inverter in my garage that converts the DC energy into AC energy that my house can then use. I also have 2 Tesla Powerwalls and a smart panel from Span, giving me a really complete home energy system that's pretty advanced. But if you want to learn more about those other systems, check the description down for links to those videos. And where I live in California, we have net energy metering, which means that I can actually sell energy back to the grid and build up credits with my local utility. Coincidentally, this is what makes having a home battery not a financially beneficial option for most people. If you're in the United States, you likely already live in a state with net energy metering. But if you're not sure, I'll put a link to an article from Energy Sage that has more detail on it down in the description below. So basically, that's my setup. The sun comes up, it generates energy. Any excess that I'm not using at that exact moment goes back to the grid, and then later I can buy back that energy at a later time. The question now is, after 4 years, how's it going? How much energy have they generated? And is there anything I would do differently? Let's start with the most important question you probably are wondering about. Is it worth it financially? So since install back in March of 2017, my solar panels have generated 35,480 kilowatt hours, which costs an average of 27 cents where I live. Except now in 2021, it's 31 cents thanks to a rate hike from our local utility. And when you multiply those two, you get $9,683.60. This is how much the energy is worth that my panels have generated over the 4 years that I've had them. And looking at the net cost of the system, right around $14,000 minus the power walls, we find that I'm about 70% paid off from the initial investment in just 4 years. And this is good news because the original quote I got from the installer had us right around $9,200 worth of energy at this point, not $9,600. So we're a little bit ahead of schedule when it comes to these panels paying themselves off. And then if we forecast out from here, looking at our yearly average consumption of 8,500 kilowatt hours and the new energy cost of 31 cents per kilowatt hour, we see that they should have paid for themselves in about year 6, or a half a year ahead of schedule from our initial estimate. Again, that's partly aided by the energy price hike from my local utility, but this is just how things go. Every year, the prices go up just a little bit. Now, if we extrapolate that for the next 25 years, we're looking at about an $85,000 profit, assuming that the annual reduction in photovoltaic production is around 0.4% and the annual utility rate increase is around 5%. So are they worth it? Totally. But it doesn't mean that I didn't make any mistakes along the way and have anything that I would have done differently. When I first started this journey, I used Energy Sage to find my installer. The way it works is by submitting your information, your electricity bill, and putting a pin on your roof so they can see exactly the orientation of your house and if there's any shade or anything nearby. Then getting quotes from various installers without them ever getting your personal information, which means no one's going to be calling you or stopping by unannounced trying to sell you something. You just get a nicely laid out dashboard inside of their portal on energysage.com to compare all of these quotes. And with summer right around the corner, now is a great time to head over to bensolins.com/energysage, sign up, and get quotes for your house to see how much you could be saving. Again, there's no obligations there if you head over. It's all free. You sign up, you get the information, all that. The actual installers are the ones that pay a commission to Energy Sage, so that's how that whole thing works. Totally free to you. And even if you already have quotes from other people, I would highly recommend it just to get more kind of second and third opinions out there just to see what kind of deals and what kind of quotes you can get. So thanks to Energy Sage for sponsoring the channel. Again, they're one of my favorite partners that I've been recommending for years on and off the internet. And so I really do believe in what they have to offer, as well as it's one of the best websites just to learn about this stuff. So give them a look, link in the description, or just bensolins.com/energysage. Okay, so the biggest thing that I've learned over this time that I would do differently is that there's a fixed cost to even getting one solar panel on your house. The way it works when you get this process going is that you have an installer design a system for you, which basically means where are the panels going to go and how are they going to connect to the grid. The installer there has to submit those plans to the city or your local utility or whomever kind of has jurisdiction in that area and get it approved. And you likely have to then get a permit, which you have to pay for. This is all to be done before you can actually move ahead with the install. So if you want one panel on your house, you'd have to do all these steps. Or if you want 100 panels on your house, you would also have to do all of these steps. So the lesson here is that you should probably get as much solar energy as you think you will ever need. Not just how much you need now, but how much you might think you need within the next 25 years. So if you think you might get an electric car or two within the next 25 years, or maybe you're gonna be working from home and your kids are gonna be home when they should be in school and your energy needs are gonna go up because of that, yeah, you might want to get more panels now than you think you need. So what that means is when you get these quotes, they're going to say, hey, this is going to cover 98% of your energy needs or something like that. And yeah, you can buy some energy from the local utility because it's just going to be cheaper. But that's today. In the next 25 years, chances are your energy needs are going to go up. A lot of appliances in our house are switching over to electric, and overall, we're just going to be using more and more energy. So my recommendation, the thing I wish I would have done differently, is just got as many panels as my roof could hold. That, of course, is within reason, right? If you have this massive house that could hold, you know, 100 panels or something crazy, I'm not suggesting go, you know, 2 or 3x what your energy needs are today. I'm just suggesting that when you do the layout, if you have room for like 4 or 5 extra panels like I did, go for it, because the cost of adding those 4 or 5 panels now is going to be far cheaper than trying to add them later. Also, if you want to add them later, there's a good chance that those same panels aren't in manufacturing anymore. They're not in production. So you'll get a different kind of panel, which will look different, giving your roof this kind of patchwork design, which personally, I just am not a fan of. So if you have a layout, if you're doing some stuff here, you're already going to be going down this route, I do recommend that you get kind of, you kind of max it out to an extent that makes sense for your family's needs and, you know, your future potential needs. The next thing is the type of inverter that you want to get. Now, I have a string inverter, which is this big box in my garage. These do tend to have better durability than some of the other types of inverters, but my house and my garage are really small, and I would totally rather have these located underneath the panels, all tucked away with microinverters. Microinverters tend to be a bit more expensive than the other options out there, but they do give you panel level monitoring, meaning you can look at each panel and how it's doing. And most importantly, for me anyways, they are completely hidden underneath the panels. So you don't have this big box inside of your garage taking up all this room. Now, however your panel and system get designed, you could put that box, that inverter, somewhere else. For me, I put it in the garage because that's where I wanted my power walls to go, only later to learn that I couldn't have my power walls in there because there wasn't enough room due to the fire code or whatever. It just wouldn't be a place that I could actually have them. So yeah, I have this big box in there taking up this room on this wall that's super precious and valuable in this really small garage, and I can't really move it. So pay attention to that, and pay attention to the kind of inverter, because if I were to do it again, I would have got the microinverters, which are all tucked up underneath the panels, and there's nothing else that you have to install. No other big boxes outside your house or in the garage or anywhere else. For us, that would be a big win. And again, depending on your situation, there could be other options, but just pay attention to that when you get your system designed. And again, all of this info is on Energy Sage. I'll put a link to an article that they have, which really just breaks it all down for you in case you're curious. And then that way, when you go into these discussions about what kind of inverter would make sense for you, you can already have this knowledge at your disposal. And lastly, the thing I would probably do differently is get a different design of solar panel. The ones I have, you can kind of see the layout of where the solar cells are, but now they have these ones that are just all black. They just look like a black sheet of glass, and it just looks a lot cleaner, I feel like, on your roof than what I have. And again, Now, because I've had these for 4 years, if I wanted to add more panels, they're not going to match the same design, giving it a really kind of odd look on the roof, more so than you already may think how odd they look already, because it is one of the things people talk about, how ugly solar panels are. I've never felt that way, but when I see them with different mismatched designs, I definitely think like something's wrong there. And so that's another reason, again, to just get more solar than you think you'll need right now. And that way you save money on that whole setup again. And then the design, if that's important to you at all, is something that will at least match down the road. All told, I'm really happy that we got solar when we did. And I really do recommend it to almost everyone out there. Again, if you want to get a quote for your house, head over to bensolens.com/energysage, upload your info, and just start seeing what installers would put on your house and how much it would cost and all that. There's no obligations again, and it's just more info that you can use to make a better decision, which of course is what I'm all about. Also, if you want to learn more about my Powerwall setup and how I've tuned it to actually save me even more money using the timer use pricing and this thing called peak shaving, check out this video over here. I did it not too long ago, and I think there's some really great info on there that might help you decide whether or not a home battery is also worth it for you. That's it for this one, guys. Let me know what you think down in the comments. Thanks for watching again, and I'll see you back here in the next one.